Greetings from EPG Pathshala. In this module, I am going to discuss about digital signature. I would first start with how message encryption can be used for authentication, confidentiality, and signature. Then we will be starting a discussion about a general architecture of the digital signature. Then we will be talking about primitive roots. What is a primitive root? Why we are going to discuss about primitive roots? Because the next discussion is about LGAML digital signature, which uses primitive roots as a computational parameter. So first of all, we would start with message encryption, how it can be used for confidentiality, authentication, and digital signature. We have seen symmetric encryption, in which the sender and receiver, source and destination, both uses the same key. We can always achieve confidentiality and authentication through this symmetric encryption. As you can see in the block diagram, message M is an input to the encryption algorithm. At the same time, key is also an input. Output we get is an encrypted message, which will be fed to the decryption algorithm. In the decryption algorithm, once again, a key would be fed and we will get our message back. What we have achieved in this confidentiality, that means message is encrypted with the key, so nobody else can see the message. And the second is, if a receiver is able to retrieve the message with the key, that means authentication is also performed. In case of public key encryption, what we are using public key for the encryption and private key for the decryption. The process is clear. Message would be fed to the encryption algorithm. At the same time, the public key would be fed. Whose public key we have to use? We have to use receiver's public key. So B is the receiver, then we will use the public key of B. The encrypted message would be sent to the receiver. On the receiver side, this decryption algorithm would be applied, and this time the receiver would feed its a private key. So that is denoted by PRB, and the message would be retrieved back. What have we achieved through this? We have achieved confidentiality, because the data transmitted is in the encrypted form and only the users with the legitimate key can decrypt it. The next question is, using this public key encryption, can we achieve authentication and signature? For that, what we are going to do, when we are feeding a message to the encryption algorithm, first we are going to encrypt with the private key of a sender. Meaning that A is the sender, the encryption would be done with private key of A, that is PRA. And what we achieve is the encrypted output, but this time with a private key of sender. If it would be sent to the receiver, and receiver would apply the decryption algorithm with public key of the sender, we will denote it by PUA. And if a receiver is able to get the message back, then we have performed the authentication. Saying that the message was signed by A only, because receiver is able to decrypt it. This structure represents two things, authentication and signature. So using public key encryption, we can achieve authentication as well as signature. Now you can imagine, if we want to achieve confidentiality, authentication and signature all together through public key, what we have to do? Message first should be fed to the encryption algorithm. The question is, first we would do authentication or confidentiality? So answer is, first authentication should be applied. That means our message or whatever input message is given, it should be first encrypted with a private key of a sender. That means first the sender should sign that, oh yes, I am the one who is sending the message. Then this encrypted message would again be fed to the encryption algorithm, and this time it would be encrypted with a public key of receiver. Meaning that if the receiver is B, this time the encryption should be done with a public key of B, saying P, U, B, what have we achieved? We have achieved confidentiality. If I represent them mathematically, the first we have done encryption with private key of the sender P, R, A on M, and then we have done the encryption with a public key of the receiver, that is P, U, B. On the receiver side, the reverse process would happen. First, the message would be decrypted with a private key of the receiver, that is PRB, and then it would be decrypted with the help of public key of the sender, that is PUA, and the message, original message, would be retrieved. So through this sequence, we have achieved confidentiality, authentication, and signature. What is the general model of a digital signature? So Bob, if Bob wants to sign the message, Bob's private key would be fed to the digital signature algorithm. S is the Bob's signature for message M. So message M and S would be appended. What the Alice would do? Alice would take the apply the digital verification algorithm through Bob's public key and then verify that the signature is valid or not. What are the elements of digital signature process? So we have started with Bob's private key. Message M would be forwarded to the cryptographic hash functions. Hash would be generated. That hash along with the Bob's private key would be encrypted to generate S, that is a digital signature. On the other side, message M would be applied, the cryptographic hash function H would be generated, S is already transmitted, so S would be decrypted to H. Now cryptographic hash generated through message and cryptographic hash decrypted from S would be compared, and then it would be verified whether the signature is valid or not. Properties of digital signature say verify the author and the date and time of the signature. Authenticate the contents at the time of the signature. Verifiable by third parties to resolve the dispute. What are the attacks and forgeries that can happen on digital signature? The first is key only attacker. Attacker knows user's public key. So if attacker knows user's public key, he can decrypt it with the public key and get the message, even though it is signed by the private key of the user. Known message attack. Attacker is given access to a set of messages and their signatures. So given a message and message, it can match the signature and find out what is the original message. So given a signature, attacker would try to match the signature and accordingly it will identify what is the message. Generic chosen message attack, directed chosen message attack, and adaptive chosen message attack. Or in all case, the attacker has chosen the message, accordingly the signature is with it. And it through the signature, it can find out what message is being transmitted. After breaking a digital signature scheme, attacker can do a total break. That means adversary is able to find the secret for signing, so he can sign any message. Universal forgery. Now he can sign any of the message. Selective forgery, it is able to create valid signatures on a message chosen by someone else with a significant probability of having the signature correct. Existential forgery, adversary can create a pair, message and signature, so that the signature of message is valid. What are the digital signature requirements? It requires the bit pattern that is derived based on a message. Given a message, bit pattern should be able to derive. Must use unique information to prevent forgery and denial. means every time a digital signature is generated, something is fed that is unique, so that the signature generated is not repeated. Digital signature should be easy to produce, easy to recognize and verify, computationally infeasible to forge a digital signature. Practically, it is possible to retain a copy of the signature in storage. So the requirement is ki if we have a digital signature, we should be able to have its copy on our storage so that we can append whenever is necessary. Direct digital signature, it involves only the communicating parties. We are now going to talk about L-Gamal digital signature. So in L-Gamal digital signature, decryption is done by a user's private key. And when we are talking about L-Gamal encryption scheme, the encryption is done by a user's private key and decryption is done by user's public key. The fundamental it uses is fundamental of primitive root. So now let's check what is a primitive root. If GCD, G of N equal to 1, that means given G and N are relatively prime and is of multiplicative order 5N modulo N, where 5N is a totient function, then G is a primitive root of N. Simply we will try out G and we will try to take its exponent starting with 5N and going up to 1, and if it generates all the possible values between 0 to n minus 1, then we will say that the G is a primitive root of N. Once again, when I say primitive root, there are two things. One is GCD, GN should be 1, that is G and N are relatively prime, and G is of multiplicative order 5N modulo N. 5N, you all know, it is a totient function. Then we will conclude G is a primitive root. By words of definition, you are not clear what is a primitive root. Let's check one example. We are taking mod 7 and we want to find out whether 3 is a primitive root in mod 7. So doing an analogy with definition, G is 3, N is 7. In case of N equal to 7, the totient function is 6. Just to remind you, when I say totient function for any value N being prime, its a totient function would be N minus 1. And if N is not prime, what you need to do, you need to start from 1 to N minus 1, find out what all values are relatively prime with given N, and keep the count of those numbers which are relatively prime, and that count becomes 5N for you. In our case, we have taken mod 7. 7 is a prime number, so our totient function would be 6. 5N would give 6. The question basically was, is 3 a primitive root in mod 7? So what the definition said, start from 1 and go up to 5N in the multiplicative order and check the remainder. If the remainder comes out to be all values from 1 to 5N, then 3 is a primitive root. So if I say 3 raised to 1, it comes out to be 3. Don't forget, we are working with modulo 7. 3 square gives 9, so it results in 2 when I take modulo 7. 3 cube gives 6. 3 raised to 4 gives us 18, and that results in 4 if we take modulo 7. 3 raised to 5 gives 5, and 3 raised to 6 gives 1. So sequences, for 3 raised to 1 we got 3, 3 raised to square we got 2, 3 raised to cube we got 6, 3 raised to 4 we got 4, 3 raised to 5 we got 5, 3 raised to 6 we got 1. So we have covered all the values in the range of 1 to 6. And we can say 3 is a primitive root in mode 7. Now, for a prime number q, alpha is a primitive root of q, then alpha square, going up to alpha q minus 1, they are distinct in mode q. Alpha is a primitive root of q, then for any integer m, alpha raised to m is congruent to 1 mod q, if and only if m is congruent to 0 mod q minus 1. And for any integer I and j, alpha raised to I is congruent to alpha raised to j mod q, if and only if I is congruent to j in mod q minus 1. Let's start discussion about L-Gamma digital signature. The global elements are 2, prime number q, and then we have a, which is a primitive root of q. So now you got my point, why did we discuss about the primitive root? We have to find out a such that it is a primitive root of q, and q is nothing but a prime number. Going ahead with the discussion of L-Gamma digital signature, user A generates a private public key pair as follows. So once again, we are dealing with public key cryptography to generate the signature. Generate a random integer XA such that 1 is less than XA is less than Q minus 1. I hope there is no need to remind what is Q, but still Q is a prime number. We need to compute Y of A that is equal to alpha raised to X A mod Q. Alpha is nothing but a primitive root of Q. A's private key is X A and A's public key is Q alpha and ya. Sounds simple because we need only three things: generate a random integer, but only thing to keep in mind, it should be within the range of 1 to q minus 1, compute ya, that is nothing but a result of a primitive root raised to the xa mod q, and then we are set with the private key of a, that is xa, and public key is q alpha and ya. So everybody knows which prime number we have used, which primitive root we have used, and what is ya. But to sign a message m, user a computes the hash m that is equal to h of m, and m is in the range of 0 to m to q minus 1. What L-Gamma digital signature does further, user A forms digital signature as follows. It chooses a random integer k. Once again, k is in the range of 1 to q minus 1. And GCD, that is greatest common divisor between k and q minus 1, is 1. We can say, in other words, k is a relative prime to q minus 1. Compute S1. S1 is nothing but alpha raised to k mod q. Q is known, alpha is known, k is known at this point of the algorithm. Third step says compute k inverse mod q minus 1. Fourth step says compute S2, that is k inverse m minus xa S1 mod q minus 1. So this time we are dealing with k inverse, k we defined in the first step, k inverse m minus xa s1, m is the modulo we have used, and here mod q minus 1, m is a message we have used, and m minus xa s1 mod q minus 1. The signature consists of the pair S1 and S2. What a user B do at the verifying side? It computes V1 because alpha is known, M is known, and it does alpha raised to M mod Q, and Q is known. It computes V2 by what it does YA raised to S1, S1 raised to S2 and mod Q. If V1 comes out to be equal to V2, then the signature is valid. To prove that, prove the point that the digital signature works, what we did is alpha raised to m mod q is equal to ya raised to s1, s1 raised to s2 mod q. Alpha raised to m mod q is equal to alpha raised to x, a raised to s1, alpha raised to k s2 mod q. We have substituted the value of ya and s1. If we do more simplification, we will get alpha m minus x a raised to s1 mod q is equal to alpha raised to k s2 mod q. This comes out to be m, because on the both sides now the power is of the base alpha, we can compare the powers. So powers are m minus x a s1, it is congruent to k s2 mod q minus 1. Because power computation is always done in the modulo q minus 1. So now m minus x a s1 is congruent to k k inverse. Because if we substitute the value of s2, it comes out to be k k inverse m minus x a s1. In mod q minus 1. So kk inverse is cancelled out and left and right side both comes out to be equal. That says that our L-Gamal digital signature is proving to be valid mathematically. For example, consider the L-Gamal digital signature where we will start q equal to 19. They have a primitive root 2, 3, 10, 13, 14 and 15. Let's start with primitive root 10. Generate a key pair. XA is equal to 16. Y is equal to YA to be alpha raised to XA mod Q. We know all the values. We have taken alpha to be 10. So 10 raised to 16 mod 19, that would give 4. So private key this time will be 16 and public key would be Q, alpha and YA. So private key would be 19, 10 and 4. To sign a message with hash value m equal to 14, user chooses k equal to 5, which is relatively prime to q minus 1 equal to 18. S1 is equal to alpha raised to k mod q. So it is nothing but 10 raised to 5 mod 19 equal to 3. K inverse mod q minus 1 would be 5 inverse mod 18, that is equal to 11. S2 is equal to k inverse m minus x a s1 mod q minus 1. All values are known, so we will have k inverse to be 11, m to be 14, because this is the message hash value m, which is in form of message we want to sign. 14 minus 16 into 3 mod 18. So it comes out to be minus 374 mod 18. If you simplify that, you would end up in 4. So S1 is 3 and S2 is 4. On the verifying side, V1, that is alpha raised to m mod q, we have used the hash value m to be 14. So 10 raised to 14 mod 19 equal to 16. And V2 is equal to YA raised to S1, S1 raised to S2 mod Q. Value of YA is 4, S1 is 3, S1 is 3 and S2 is 4. So 4 cube and 3 raised to 4 mod 19 would end up in 5184 mod 19 equal to 16. V1 16, V2 16, that says the signature is verified and found to be valid. Hashing in digital signature, the application is one-way hash function. We can use public key algorithms. Hashing in digital signature, we can use public key algorithms for password login, encryption key management, and digital signatures. We can even do integrity checking, virus, and malware scanning. And we can do authentication, that is secure web connections, PGP, SSL, SSH, SMIME. They all use hashing in digital signature for authentication. There are variants of hashing available, MD4 and MD5 by Ron Rivest, SHA0, SHA1 by NSA, RIPE MD160, SHA2, Whirlpool, Tiger, Ghost 3411 and SHA3. Hashing in digital signature is applied like this. Message is inputted and its a hash is generated. Message and hash would be passed to the receiver side. On the receiver side, again the hash would be generated by the because message is there, so you can generate a hash, and this hash would be compared with a passed hash from the sender side, and if they prove out to be same, then comparison is valid. This module we talked about the hashing, we talked about the primitive roots, and we talked about AlGaML digital signature. Thank you.